beyond that, they'll be you, and then you move beyond that to others who are interested in studying the Greek language and just the New Testament scripture. So let me ease your mind. I know there's a lot, when you start this, a lot of apprehension, a lot of anxiety that you can't do that. But I can assure you, you can. And if you'll stick with it, you'll find out at the end of it, you've made it perfect. And I remember in one of the classes that I had somewhere in your life, somebody had made this statement, if you can be as dumb as a stick and learn Greek. And I'm not implying everybody in here is dumb as a stick. But you can make that. You absolutely can. So, and I know that we had, some of you may have a textbook and some may not. I don't be concerned about the main reason that I ask you to get a textbook is to learn the vocabulary, because there are vocabulary words that are given in each lesson. If I had some way to reprint those, I would. It's easier to just have you have a book. At the start of each lesson, there'll be a list of vocabulary words. Not worried about that at the moment, because I'll begin to sign those words for you. Pilgrim, there was a great scholar. Richard is in my class in the school.
Yes, sir. Hey, how can I get a little bit more volume out of Dr. Cliff on Facebook?
Across this morning in my quiet time, I've been reading through some periods. And this one was quite interesting, and it relates to what we're about to embark on. And the title of this one is this.
He's going over to the
Puritans were in the 1550s and on above, who realized that the Anglican Church had not reformed enough out of the Catholic Church that they were greatly concerned with what the Anglican Church was teaching the Church of England. So they broke away.
Okay, it's all good, man. We're great. I appreciate you.
Okay. We've lost that in our country already, because we don't teach history. Children don't know who the Puritans were. They don't realize that they came across when they came across. But anyway, this is from a bird, Puritan. When the enemy steals our weapon, and he takes the text of Satan being tempting Jesus in the wilderness. And Jesus said unto him, get thee, and this is Puritan language, get thee hence, Satan, for it is written. So this is what the Puritan said. But what is this? Satan himself, with a Bible under his arm and a text in his mouth, it is written. Who could not but overwonder at this if he did not consider that since the devil dared to touch the sacred body of Christ with his hand, he may well touch the scriptures of God with his tongue? Let no man henceforth marvel to hear heretics or hypocrites quote scripture. Hear that today? Most certainly do, folks. When Satan himself has not spared disciples, how many thousand souls are betrayed by the abuse of the word, whose use is sovereign and saving? No devil is so dangerous as the religious devil. What can be a better act than to speak scripture? It is a wonder if Satan does a good thing well. He cites scripture, but with mutilation and distortion, it comes out of his mouth maimed and perverted. One piece is left and all is misapplied. Those that wrestle or mangle scripture for their own purpose, it is easy to see from what school they come from. And that just struck me, and I'm of course I couldn't eat. And the reason I did this, folks, the the real New Testament is the Greek New Testament. There are a lot of translations today, and I'm not belittling those. But they are just that. They're translations. An English, whatever translation you use, is simply a translation of the New Testament. It's not the actual New Testament. And the reason why this is so important, there are a whole lot of things that cannot be translated into English. The Greek language is so rich and so clear and powerful that we sometimes don't have any words in English to portray that meaning. And this is why, and again, there are preachers in here and some that have surrendered to the ministry, and I hammer that home in Christ. Week after week after week, if you do not know the languages, you are depriving your people of a richness they cannot ever find on their own. And I'm not saying you cannot study the Bible and understand it. You can. But if you don't know the riches of it, of the New Testament, and here we're talking about Greek, then you're going to miss out on something for your own personal use. And if you are a preacher, a teacher, or Sunday school teacher, you're not going to be able to portray that to your class the way that you want to. And they're not going to see the richness of it. I'm talking about Greek. Let me give an example of that over in Hebrew. I was preaching through the Messianic Psalms, and I got Psalm 22. And there's an interesting verse that David used in there. And when you read this psalm, you realize that this cannot refer to David. It has to look beyond him, because he's quoting Jesus from the cross, and he's describing the vividness of the agony that Jesus went through. And then you come to the little verse that says, I am a worm. Well, that puzzles people. Why would he describe himself as a worm? And when I went to the Hebrew to look up that word worm, it describes a little larva. When it is crushed, bleeds red. And I almost shouted hallelujah when I found that out. What a vivid picture this is of the death of Christ on the cross. Never would have, well, we could pass it on. Well, he's just talking about a worm that just squiggles through the dust. No, he was about to pour out his blood. And this is in Psalm 22. These are centuries before our Lord Jesus came. And so when you come to the languages, you find a richness there you cannot find anywhere else. So I want to encourage you, just stay with it. It might seem to be difficult at first, but I'm not sure I can make it through this, but you can make it through this. And it'll give you a richness. It doesn't matter that you're not a preacher or maybe even a teacher, but for your own personal meditation back. And I'm not going to cover this up, but this takes discipline. You can't just haphazardly do this at all. So, let me share with you how we'll do this. And if you're in seminary and you take Greek, most times in the seminary, they're just teaching you to, it's an academic exercise. And they approach learning of the Greek primarily as this academic discipline. And then they fail to neglect to show you how you can take those words over to the concordance of the lexicons, and then you find the meaning and you begin to put that into practice. They don't teach you how to do that. And I'm not doing this for an academic discipline. But I think the Refuge is offered in the degree. My objective is to teach you how to get around in that Refuge question. And then how to find out the meaning of those words, or when we get to it, the tenses of the verbs and the cases of the nouns, and how all of that begins to make sense. And then we'll find that richness that we're talking about. And I will say this up front, and I don't want to scare anybody off. if you have no memory of English grammar, you better freshen up. Well, I don't know. You have to have some kind of learning about English grammar. Nouns and verbs and pronouns and adjectives and adverbs. And it will greatly enhance your learning of the Greek. So, there is memorization involved in that, and there's no way out of that. If you don't begin to memorize the vocabulary so that you can recognize the words when you see them, and the same thing is true of you. Now, a lot of people don't want to give themselves. One of the best ways to do that is to have a flashcard. These are old as dirt. I just put them together. But with a flashcard, you just put the English on one side and the Greek on the other side. So you're constantly looking at the Greek, trying to remember what that says, and if you can't, you look on the other side, and there's the English translation of it, but you carry these flashcards with you everywhere. And you can stand in line in Walmart and be quoting or saying things. When I was in Sydney and New Orleans, I'd drive home every weekend to Mississippi, and I would eventually have these flashcards, and I'd be quoting. She would call out the English word, and I would give her the Greek word. You just constantly do it. And that's the best way to learn, is repetition. So, we'll get started. I did this for you. Certainly, you have paper, and you can use your own paper to do this. This is the alphabet, and this is where you have to learn. That's how kindergarten learns. It learns the alphabet, A, B, C, D, and then you take the letters of the alphabet and you make words out of them, and then when you have words, you put them in the sentence. And this is how you start learning the Greek. And it's just a sheet. You can use your own piece of paper to help you. And I'm fixing to show you how to write these letters and how to pronounce them. And if you do this over and over and over again, just practice writing them out and saying the Greek alphabet. And we got enough. I got some more up here. I've got some more up here. I just think it's read along in the textbook, but sometimes that's confusing, and I'm proud of explaining all that.
Okay.
If you're watching online, you can text your email address to this phone number here. Michael will get back with you. So we'll have that. I'll make one more clarification. When we learn this, you're not going to be able to travel to Greece and speak it, because they don't use that. This is Koine Greek in the New Testament. That just means it's common Greek. When Alexander the Great conquered the world, his priority was to saturate the known world with Greek culture, Greek language, Greek education. And he did that. And up until that time, it was mainly classical Greek. But then the way it is here in America, you have a language and then it begins to take on its own characteristics. Until it became the common language of the world. Up until a few years ago, English was that, but it's not anymore. So when we're reading the New Testament, we're reading Koine Greek. It was the language that everybody spoke. So that's not the language that they use today in Greek. In Greece. I've been to Greece, and I can recognize some letters, but I can't, the word is different. So don't think you're going to be able to travel overseas and be able to speak this or run from the Ziggies or Euro and try to order something. I'm preaching that because he loves the Ziggies. So I won't get that out up front. This is Koine Greek. This is the language of the common man, and it is in the providence of God it was written. The New Testament was written in that common language. What a great sovereign God that we have. So we'll just dive into this. There are 24 letters in the Greek alphabet. And it's essential that you learn this Greek alphabet so that you can begin to recognize the words when you see them in the vocabulary. And this is not some in-depth study. If that's what you thought it was going to be, you just cannot do that. But we'll get through this. So we'll go over the alphabet. I will write it up here for you, and you will see how to write it down, and you can practice on that piece of paper. And then you begin to memorize the alphabet. You did that in kindergarten, or when you were in school, ABCD, you learned the alphabet, and this is what we're just in another language. There are both capital and small letters in the Greek alphabet. But for our purposes, you just concentrate on the small letters, not the capital letters. It's not that capital letters were not used, but you need to know thoroughly the small letters. There are capital letters sometimes in the Greek New Testament. At the beginning of a paragraph, it may use a capital letter. If it's a proper name, they'll use the capital letter. If they're quoting something, they'll use that capital letter. But mainly, it is written in the small letters. They're more commonly used. So for your purposes and our purposes, we'll be learning the small letters in the Greek alphabet. So you need to learn how to write these letters and pronounce the letters. That's why I gave you that sheet, and you can do this with your own piece of paper. And I don't want to get jumpy and get so lost all the time. One more thing. You can go online and you can listen to a lot of Greek teachers, and they're not going to pronounce the words the same way because we don't know how this was pronounced back then. We just simply do not. So I may pronounce a word one way, and you listen to somebody online, and they pronounce it another way. Or Richard's had Greek, so whoever taught him that may pronounce it different than I do. That's not the issue for us today. It's just learning the alphabet and how it is pronounced. So the first letter in the Greek alphabet, I'm going to go over these letters with you, and I'll show you how to write them. And especially if you're looking at the textbook, the letters are not going to be formed the same way I form them. A student asked me one day, can I borrow some of your notes? All my notes are handwritten. I don't even know how to really turn on the computer. So I copied some of those notes and gave them to him, and he came back and he said, these are useless. I can't read them. So when I'm writing these up, if it doesn't look like it is in the textbook, don't worry about it. So the first letter in the Greek alphabet, the first letter in the Greek alphabet is Alpha. And it's made like that. Now you can look at the textbook or whatever, but that's not going to look the same. The first letter is Alpha. Like Father. There are English equivalent letters to most of the Greek alphabet, but not all of them. I'll get back to that in a moment. Alpha is simple. That's an A in our English. The second letter, the reason you got that piece of paper with the lines, the second letter starts below the line is Beta. Made like that. And it's best if you just write without lifting your pen. Beta. That's equivalent to our B. So here's where the word, for instance, this is where the word alphabet comes from. These two numbers. Our English word. Alpha. Beta. Then again, you're below the line and then coming back up, Alpha, Beta, Gamma. And the more you practice this, the more it will become familiar to you. And the other one, I'll let this strike here. It's Delta. It sort of looks like Delta. Right. And it is equivalent to our D. Goes down further below the line. You know, this one I gave you got three lines on it, and that's just to help you see. Well, and don't worry about that score because and if you write it, if you were going to have a test, and I'm not going to give you a test, but if you were going to have a test, and I said I want you to write the Greek alphabet, you're not going to have necessary papers that have these kind of lines. You just know that the tail's going to be the logo. Are we lost so far? Okay, the next letter is Epsilon. And again, if you can make it without, this looks like an inverted W. Epsilon. Epsilon. There are eight vowels in the Greek alphabet. Epsilon is always a short E. This is where you go back to English. What's the difference in a long and a short vowel? It's the length of time you're saying it. And epsilon is always a short E. There's a long E we'll get to in a moment. Just like there's a long O, there's a long O. And then the third category of vowels is variables, and that means letter is used in the middle of a word, then it'll be a DZ sound instead of. And there are two or three of the letters in the Greek alphabet that look like English letters, but they're not. So you need to keep that in mind when you're learning or reading it. Ada is a long E. And the next one is Theta. Equivalent to our eye, like police, and this is one of those variables. This can be a long vowel. This one is an M and this is an N, like ours, alphabet. snitches and peeing off the paper. It's all in one sweep. Yeah, you can get right. And that unit is another one, it's got to serve the community. And I don't want you to be confused, that's why I told you right up front, if what you see printed on in books and all is gonna look entirely different than what I'm writing up here. And this one looks like a this is the letter we have to decide. Big God. God relax. So if you bring this over, the English it would be equivalent to our heads. Where we are in the headlines today, this is Omicron.
Oh, yes.
How many letters are there? How many wrote that? 44 letters. Oh, you mean the Greek? That's what I asked my son-in-law. The doctor, what are we going to do when they run out of the Greek alphabet? What are they going to name them? The virus. What's the Greek? Well, thank you. This is a short one. The last letter of a word. The bottom goes, get the bottom part out. And again, I'm getting worried about that. You can tell when it's an S at the end of the word. It's at the bottom. Like a little curve, ball. alone. Christmas, they just put the past. It's like a lesson in the news. It's sad. Sad like tops or nips. Some letters are translated after our saying the English and some do not. And do not confuse some of the Greek letters that look like English letters, that like the V is not V, it's nu. That's the N equivalent to that. Or the Rho is not an R. If I'm writing this out in English, I'm going to going to have a name sound. If it's the other way, it's just a smooth sound. And it has a smooth bark, so I'm not going to pronounce it with an H sound. So there are, if you go through this alphabet, there's 7 vowels. Alpha, Epsilon, Eta, Iota, Omicron, Upsilon.
Alpha.
Alpha. It's in your textbook somewhere.
Epsilon.
Eta. Iota. Omicron. Upsilon. And Omega. Epsilon and Omicron are always short. The Eta and Omega are always long, and the Alpha, Iota, and Upsilon may or may not be long and short. And again, long and short just refers to the length of time it requires you to pronounce the vowel. Always seems to be something extra to be had in English. There are in the Greek language that in Greek there are what they call diphthong is two vowels that are together that they just produce one sound. Two vowels that are together, but they produce a single sound. And the last vowel in the diphthong will either be iota or upsilon. And he lists those diphthongs for you, I think, in the textbook. For instance, alpha, iota, that's a diphthong. And they're written together. But it only produces one sound. It's not, they're not trying to divide the sound. Like how in English, A-I-S-L-E, how. Remember, in the diphthongs, the last vowel will either be the iota or the upsilon. Because I know this sounds confusing. And he lists those diphthongs for you. Epsilon, iota. And that's like in the word freight. Probably not listed in the textbook. tip on the leader, like the Alpha or the Epsilon. That's like soup. Soup is just the same effect. And Epsilon Alpha. Square up is root. That's one sound, each one out, got re. And then, Q. Simply means you're going to take the equivalent English letters and write the word out in English. So what? And this is where the sigma is at the end of the word, so we made like that elongated, not even having the long. And I transliterated it in English as logo. Or if I put this up here, the ending will be, this verb, let go, the first person would be, well, this is, I see. So I work my way down to first, second, and third, and I'll teach you how to do this. And this way could be plenty of involvement line. The endings of the present tense verb, O, I, si, open, head, usage. So you stand there and say that in line while you're rehearsing it. You get a little conversation going with somebody. O, I, si, open, head, usage. That's the ending. I, you, he, she, it, we, you, they. And that becomes important in Greek when you recognize those pronouns as singular or plural. So when Jesus said to Nicodemus, you must be born again, that's a plural you. He's talking about not just one person, everybody must be born again. In English, we may recognize that. You say, you, well, is that singular? Is that plural? And that makes a whole lot of difference in understanding what Jesus was saying to Nicodemus. I don't want to put your brain over and over. Does anybody have a question? No, it's overwhelming, and it's, you think that this is impossible. It's not impossible. You can do that. I had a student one day on the master's side who wants to think we can do it. And long as I read that email, and he said, not long ago, he came up to me and said, Dr. Chris, I'm not sure. I can't talk to him. I just, it's overwhelming. Not Greek, it's preaching. Right? And I said, Matthew, don't you stop. I'll take you through it. Just do not drop out. And he did not drop out, and he passed. And I got this email from him a few months ago, thanking me for encouraging him to stay with it. I'm not an expert, and I'm not a Greek scholar, but you can get through it. You can pick that up. And I mean, the diphthongs are two vowels that are together, but they produce one sound when you pronounce it. And the last vowel will either be a upsilon or an iota. So when you come across this in a word, it's just one sound. Like I'll.
Thank you.
money, but I do have to preach. Oh, goodness. There he is. There he is, what is called an idol of substitute. Over a course of time, this began to happen. There was a time when the iota would follow alpha or eta or omega, which are long vowels. But in the development of the language, the iota became mu. So, when it became mute in the pronunciation, they just put it up under like a substitute. Either the alpha or the beta or the omega. That's like a little apostrophe. It was written underneath it. Normally these would come at the end of a word. But they are considered diphthongs. They would just be pronounced like the letter on the alphabet. And that's what you're going to do when you're reading along and you say alpha, beta, or omega. You've got that stuff that swirl up underneath it. That's what you do. Over time, the iota out here just disappeared or became mute. And they just put it up under there in this like a substitute. Let me say one more thing I can say that. The learning group. Learn how to put this in English church members. If you skip something, if you skip a lesson, you're going to be lost. Because each lesson builds on the one before. In seminary, we had pop tests every day. Because if we didn't learn what we were supposed to learn the day before, the next day, we would be better. It builds on it. You can't get that across the church members. Start missing, you're going to each lesson deals on the next lesson. And we're only meeting once a week, so you can imagine that's going to be a slow process. Yep. So for instance, when the King James was written, No, you could say it's not modern. If you went over to Greece today, you could recognize letters. But this was back in Alexander the Great, when he conquered the world, he introduced this language. And before that, it was classical Greek, but not everybody knew classical Greek, but Koine became the common language, just like you. He would have done it off the manuscript evidence that was available to him, and he would have recorded it.
So to speak, the group in that particular writing is the Septuagint. But to stop and think of a fisherman in Galilee, follow up speaking Aramaic, to be able to put not only to speak a secondary language, but to be able to hear a secondary language, I don't think he gets near enough credit.
There's a very close connection to Latin and Greek. The position of that and the position of the words and the origin of the word.
I just find it funny that it just seems like a lot is not always translated or passed down to the conversation. And I think that we need to the common people.
Estes came in, that's why the reformers were trying to reform the church, because the Catholic Church, the priests were abusing all of that, and they weren't teaching the people. Well, yes. The idea of communication. In the beginning was the Word, and that's the Word of God.
Okay.
So that's a good point. So I'm looking up at the word logos to see where it stems from and what it means. And then I began to realize that it has several different meanings. So logos is the main word that describes the Lord Jesus, but it's also the main word that describes the whole of Scripture. But there's a second word in the Greek that they use that is rhema, and that describes particular things within the whole world, principles by which you and I live. So when you come across that word rhema in one of the verses that you study, pinpointing something specific within the whole building so that I can apply that to whatever circumstance situation. So the second word, the second word is one of those that starts with the rope. This rhema. That's the second word. And the English translations don't make that distinction, but they can't. We don't have one word. I think we will stress, you know, stop. In John 21, when Jesus was praying, Simon Peter. That's fishing, we're going back to fishing. And head toward the shore, Jesus is still in the boat. And then Jesus looks at Peter and says, Simon Peter, do you love me? There are three words for love. Four, but we only use two, I remember. Agape is one of them. Agape is supernatural. That comes from the God. Do you agape me, Peter? Which means, do you love me with an act of your will? And Peter responded back like this. And again, the English can show this. Lord, I phileo you. I love you like a brother. Not what Jesus asked you, but that's what he responded. Second time, do you agape me? And the second time, Peter said, I phileo you. The third time, Jesus switched words up. Do you really even phileo me, Peter? Do you love me totally and absolutely? And Peter said, I phileo you a third time. But he also added this, you know all things. You know I really do agape you, but I can't say that with my lips because my actions have demonstrated otherwise. I betrayed you. We only have one word for love in the English language, so we just say love. But when I understand the Greek, you agape me. Is an act of the will. I love you regardless of how I feel, regardless of my circumstances. There are days I get up and I don't want to go to church. But I got that and I will go. That's a something that's English can't do that because we only have that one word for that. And I know the Greek and I can see that difference. That's how people understand. I could stand up and somebody say, if I love Jesus, they're going to say, yeah. But if they don't understand the difference between agape and phileo love is up and down like an elevator. That's not what Jesus is asking. The first is you show agape. That's why it will be exciting if you just stay with it. When you begin to see these little nuances you can't express in English. Greek and Hebrew are very expressive languages. Richard can testify to that. They took that one online. But it's a very good thing. Any other questions? I don't want to delay you. I'll close that for a little bit. Leave a prayer. Yeah.
If you'll let me know.
Some have some time.
Yeah.
Well, if you would do that on lesson two, there are two columns, verbs and nouns. And they will give you the Greek word and they'll tell you what it means out on the side of it.
Dr. Cliff, you read it in the Facebook Live?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, just let them know if they have any questions, if they'll text me their email address.
Yep.
Yeah. It's That's all right.